Greetings and welcome to another thrilling episode of Veronica Explains. I'm Veronica, and I'm right in the middle of an epic volunteer project. What with it being the holidays and all. So, rather than do a huge episode of Veronica Explains, I figured I'd take a bit of time and answer some viewer questions. That's right! It's time for the first ever episode in a new series that I'm creatively calling Ask Veronica. And today we're going to talk about desktop environments.
What is a desktop environment?
A lot of you asked me, what is a desktop environment? And basically, a desktop environment is the stack of software that brings together the look and feel of your Linux system. Your taskbar, your Windows selector, your notification system, your settings area, your window decorations, that sort of thing. All of that stuff that forms the GUI of your Linux system, we usually call that a desktop environment. Typically, a distro maintainer is going to pick and choose a desktop environment that they want to support. And some distros heavily customize the desktop environment beyond what the original developers intended. Two of the most common desktop environments are GNOME, and yes, that's a proper pronunciation, as well as KDE Plasma. Linux Mint ships their own desktop environment called Cinnamon, and a few other popular options are XFCE, Mate, and the Pixel desktop from the Raspberry Pi.
What's the difference between a window manager and a desktop environment?
A few of you asked me what's the difference between a window manager and a desktop environment, and now this gets kinda jargony, but maybe we can learn something together. A window manager is part of a desktop environment, but can also be used standalone, typically by power users who enjoy heavily customizing their environment, or by folks who prefer something very lean. And to be technically correct, a window manager is an X11 thing, whereas for Wayland systems, we call it a compositor. I told you it was jargony. On my Chromebook, which is limited to 4 GB of RAM, I opted to install the Sway compositor, which adopts an auto-tiling window approach and is well-suited to a device this small. Typically, using just a window manager is going to require you to make your own decisions about utilities that help you do mundane things like connect to a Wi-Fi network or browse your file system. A desktop environment will typically provide sane defaults for those common tasks, whereas in a DIY-style window manager, you're free to pick whatever utilities you'd like, or to ditch them all as bloatware. The choice is yours, and ultimately it's going to be about how much time you want to spend learning about options and building something to taste. I tend to recommend that beginners stick to popular desktop environments, at least to start with. And you might find that you're entirely content running on a desktop environment forever. Even though I frequently bust out various compositors and window managers, my editing rig has been mostly on KDE Plasma for a while now. At least with Linux, you have choices.
Can you change desktop environments easily?
Now, most distros will let you change desktop environments pretty easily. Frankly, it's one of the nicest parts of running a Linux system. You can radically change the look and feel in ways that aren't easy at all on Windows or a Mac. But of course, that doesn't necessarily mean that you should go hog wild and install every desktop environment on a single system. Typically, your distro maintainer will pick and choose packages for the various desktop environments, and these can conflict with one another at times, or cause unforeseen behavior. For instance, if you have both GNOME and KDE Plasma installed, you might have trouble with system password prompts or file pickers not matching the rest of the system. These types of quality of life bugs typically aren't going to derail you, but they can make things painful. Not to mention that keeping extra libraries and programs installed on your system can take up a lot of space. Right now, storage is reasonably cheap, But if you're running Linux on a space-constrained system, you may want to think twice before installing new desktops. What I recommend is to look at what your distribution ships and to look and see if they have recommended packages to install if you'd like to change desktop environments. Read over the packages they recommend and then determine if you're willing to devote the time and space to figuring it all out. When I get curious about a new desktop environment, I like to try it out in a virtual machine first. If there's something really compelling about it after I've tried it virtually, I might go through the work then of installing it. That typically satisfies my hopping urge.
What desktop environment is most like Windows?
I got a few questions about desktops that look and feel like Windows. Now, admittedly, I haven't used Windows all that much since Windows XP, which I maintain both looked great and was at least as complicated to install as Arch Linux is today. It's easy to point at KDE Plasma and say, this is like Windows, because of both the default position of the taskbar as well as the familiar behavior of the super key, which some folks call the Windows key. I don't know if I see it quite so black and white, though. Modern Windows is an exercise in removing your choices. You have fewer customization options than ever before. You can't even move the taskbar to the top of the screen without some registry hack. And someone at Microsoft is probably working right now to break OOBE/bypass NRO. KDE Plasma is essentially the opposite of that approach. So much of the desktop can be tweaked, modified, and customized. Want a global menu like macOS? Plasma. Prefer a vintage vibe? Plasma. Want something super minimal that still includes sane defaults? Plasma. So while KDE Plasma might resemble Windows in the default look, I just don't think it's very similar to Windows in spirit at all. The best two distros I can think of for a beginner to try KDE Plasma are Kubuntu and Fedora's Plasma Spin. And next release, Fedora is going to upgrade the Plasma Spin to an equal distro alongside GNOME, further cementing Plasma's place in the space. That said, if you're coming from Windows and looking for a rational choice to get started with Linux, I've got to throw out the old standby, Linux Mint. The overall look and feel is going to be consistent with Windows users, but it's not quite as customizable as KDE Plasma. And for beginners to Linux, that might be a good thing. Linux Mint still has one of the best installation and initial setup experiences in modern Linux, and I think that they do the best job of shepherding the new Linux user into our space.
What helps my productivity the most when considering a desktop environment?
That's a great question. And for me, I tend to like something that I can customize enough to stay out of my way. And that's going to look different for different tasks. On my editing rig, where I get few notifications because I'm knee-deep in editing, KDE Plasma does just fine. But I don't always like it on my laptop because the notifications about every little thing can be a bit much there. Now, lately on my laptop, I've enjoyed XFCE because I could customize my theme into this abomination, which I kind of love and might just keep forever. When I was traveling around doing dev and sysadmin work, I very much appreciated the GNOME-based tiling and stacking in PopOS, and I'll certainly be reviewing their Cosmic desktop environment when it gets to beta status.
Why is fractional scaling still a problem on Linux?
A few folks asked me about fractional scaling, and I've got to say that I don't have a lot of experience with it. But the idea behind it is to scale your window features in a way that isn't an integer. For example, scaling everything on the screen 1.25 times instead of 1 time or 2 times. When I went from a 1080 display to a 4K display, I just opted to scale to 2x, and that was easy peasy. To me, personally, fractional scaling doesn't make a lot of sense because I have to imagine that there's some kind of performance penalty in scaling beyond simple integers, and I'm sure someone's in the comments right now telling me how I'm wrong about that. To be clear, though, I'm not a desktop dev, and maybe it's better now than it used to be. In my limited testing, scaling beyond integers caused some apps to misbehave, but apparently the desktops are all working on it. In the meantime, the few times I've used an awkward screen size, I just opted to increase the overall system font size, and that worked fine for me. What makes this even easier is just doing all of your work in the terminal.
Which desktop environment is the most popular?
So one of my supporters asked me this on Discord. Oh, did I forget to mention there's a Discord for patrons and Ko-fi members now? Veronica's Awesome Club. It's bridged to Matrix. The truth is that it's really hard to tell what's popular, because analytics only get us so far, and a lot of users don't share analytics back with distro managers. What I know is that popular distros like Ubuntu, PopOS, and Fedora ship GNOME by default. But in two of those cases, that's changing. PopOS will soon be shipping their own custom solution called Cosmic, and Fedora is going to be shipping default versions of Fedora with both GNOME and KDE Plasma at some point soon. We don't quite know how that's going to work out yet, but it's different than it is now. And Plasma, while not the current default among those popular distros, is currently very common among folks who pick less opinionated distros, such as Debian, Arch, and Gentoo. Based on the comments I get, my gut tells me that KDE Plasma might be the most popular. And when I asked Fedi users about the choice between Mate, LXQT, XFCE, and Cinnamon, I was surprised to see XFCE take the lead pretty decisively. So I guess the answer is I have no idea.
Will all of these Linux desktops ever play nice with one another?
Another of my supporters asked if the desktops will ever play nice in regards to interoperability. And this is one area where, for better or worse, I'm actually really excited about Wayland. I know. Put the torches and pitchforks away. I know. Now, if you don't know, and I'm overgeneralizing for time, Wayland is a new display protocol which replaces the aging and perhaps unmaintainable X11. If you don't already have strong opinions on this, good for you. I tend to be of the opinion that Wayland is inevitable, so we might as well try to make as much as possible work with it, and work well. Now, do I imagine a hypothetical future in which GTK theming looks great on Plasma, and GNOME knows exactly how to work with Qt applications? And yes, that's how you pronounce it. No, probably not. But I don't know if they need to. In my last non-live video, I discussed Shortwave, a GNOME Circle application which I regularly use on KDE Plasma. And you know what? It looks fine to me. See, the thing is, nobody complains about programs looking out of place on Microsoft Windows, which has at least two control panels, or a disk format utility that doesn't look like it's been updated in decades. Frankly, I think most of us care more about stability than we do about how nice everything looks together. And I have hope that Wayland will finally help make that happen. What I do know is that we're super lucky to have such a plethora of desktop choices here in the Linux world. I know it can seem daunting, and honestly, I get it. That's why I'm so blunt about recommending Linux Mint, at least for right now at the moment, to beginners. Because I genuinely feel that Linux Mint and their Cinnamon desktop do a fantastic job of helping new folks get acclimated to the scene. Maybe you stay there on Mint, or maybe you don't. For all of the decision paralysis that choosing a desktop environment can entail, I'm just glad that we've come so far to have such fine options. Because Linux is awesome. And wait a second, I forgot to tell you about my second channel.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, so I recently launched a channel that I'm calling Veronica Explains Nothing. And it's going to be the location for videos which are less explanation and more demonstration. Or in other words, everything that isn't my typical polished videos. If you are one of the few who enjoyed my Commodore keyboard video, or you want to see me repair random objects, or maybe show off my Bop It collection, go subscribe over there. I'll still be posting my usual, more polished explanations over here on this channel, explaining the topics that I find interesting in vintage tech, random finds, and of course, Linux. Because Linux is awesome, and so are you. You're still watching. Well, as long as you're here, what subject should I do for the next episode of Ask Veronica? You should put a comment in the comment place to let me know.